I will present you the main message that we want to know about obese management in anesthesia care. First of all, an introduction that you know today the obese patient increased in the world, over the world, and then the bariatric surgery is increasing over the world, and then more and more anesthesia physicians should manage this type of patient. Second message is that today we know that having cancer is a risk factor than to be obese patient. In other words, being obese patient is at high risk to have a cancer. Then the consequence is probably then tomorrow in our operating room, all anesthesia in the world will manage more and more obese patients, not only for bariatric surgery, but also for non-bariatric surgery and mainly for cancer. Then the last message is for the majority of the study, mainly for the randomized controlled trial, non-obese patients are the main patients studied. Then the obese patient for the majority of the studies are excluded. Then we should absolutely be careful about the transfer of the message of the different studies. So, two major modifications of the respiratory system in obese patients should be known. First of all, as you know very well, you have, as you see here, you have the upper airway collapse increase due to the morphology of the obese patient, but also due to anesthetic drug, which increase the collapses due to the respiratory depression. The second modification, as you know here, is that the restrictive syndrome. The restrictive syndrome is a decrease of the whole volume of the lung, mainly the functional residual capacity due to the as you see here, the fat part of the mediastin, but also the increase of the intra-abdominal pressure at the increase and goes to the part of the lung, as we call the diaphragm part, the dependent diaphragm part, and increase here, as you know, the atelectasis. This modification all are increased by the effect of the surgery and the effect of the anesthesia drug, and they will have some major consequences as that will be presented by the last speaker, Olfa. So, to manage a patient, you need to have three components. First of all, a good evaluation of the preoperative part. You should evaluate the comorbidity of the patient, and I recommend you each time to inform the patient. This is very important to have a good information to discuss with the patient, ideally with the surgeon, and explain to the patient what we need, what we will do, all the team to manage it during surgery and after surgery. The second part is, as you know, the perioperative, and I will focus on it. And this started by the pre-oxygenation, then optimal ventilation and hemodynamic management. And now we have recently new data about the anesthetic drug that manage. And Jérôme will present you some recent data about the OFA, which is opioid-free analgesia. And last, we have the post-operative management using the good ventilatory support after surgery to have a suppleance of the diaphragm dysfunction and the modification of the respiration and a thromboprophylaxis optimal. So this is a classical patient, and this patient allowed us to show his photo. And then, as you know, this patient have a BMI of 85 kilograms per meter square. And my main message for this young patient, as you see here, is 23 years. And then this patient have arterial hypertension, the coronopathy, the cardiac dysfunction, and the stroke antecedent. So my message is for this type of patient, you should know that half of them have an apnea syndrome obstructive, as you see, and the association of this cardiac vascular modification, the respiratory modification, as you know, increase the morbidity and the mortality. Then for each patient, probably with morbid obesity, you should make a good cardiac evaluation with a good respiratory evaluation to try to detect an apneic syndrome. Then the real situation, what you do? You have this patient in the consultation, two situations. One, that we know very well the patient have an apneic syndrome with a home CPAP. This is a very easy. Then you should ask the patient to come with his machine or her machine the day before surgery. And the message is immediately after surgery, you should take on his machine of CPAP or non-invasive ventilation early as possible, probably in post-anesthesia care. The second situation is the diagnostic of apneic syndrome is not known. Then you should try to make the diagnostic and in an easy way, not complicated to have quickly. One of a simple method is to use this score developed in the Canada by the team of Canada is the stop bank score. As you know here, you should try to evaluate the snoring. You evaluate if the patient is tired, you evaluate the way he's breathing during sleeping, and then with some pause of breathing. The blood pressure, this is a stop one, and the bang is the BMI above 35, sorry for the mistake, age above 50 years, the neck, more than 40 centimeter, and the sex gender. And then if you have a score above or equal to 5, the probably the risk is very high and you need to have a monitoring of polygraphy or polysomnography. And then the message, if you detect such diagnostic of apneic syndrome, probably it would be recommended to use a non-invasive or CPAP ventilation at home at least 2 or 4 weeks before surgery to be efficient and to improve outcome. Then the strategy during surgery is to have this strategy developed by our French group with Emmanuel Futier, the POP ventilation, POP for the perioperative positive pressure, that means a preventive positive pressure to try to maintain during all the procedure the lung open and to avoid, as you understand, the collapses of the alveoli. It will start at very early with a positive pre-oxygenation. Second, with the intraoperative lung protective ventilation and at least a prophylactic non-invasive or CPAP after surgery. The concept is first to avoid large tidal volume and high pressure during surgery and also to avoid alveolar collapse to prevent the atelectasis by first limited tidal volume. And now we have some strong data suggesting to use 6 to 8 milliliters per kilogram of predicted body weight and use positive and expiratory pressure above 8 to 10 centimeters of water, especially in the obese patient. That if you decrease tidal volume, you should increase PEEP to maintain a similar intrathoracic pressure. Then the key message are which type of mode, pressure or volume are equivalent if you applied a similar assist pressure. If you use pressure, be careful, you should monitor the tidal volume. And if you use volume, you should monitor the pressure, and mainly the plateau pressure. Which tidal volume? Probably between 6 to 8. 8 is very easy to remember, or 7 to 8 milliliters per kilogram of predicted body weight. Which PEEP? 8 to 10 centimeter. Probably above for some patient, that a strategy of individualization, not only for the drug, but also for hemodynamic and ventilation. And the recruitment maneuver should be considered each time when you have an hypoxemia for this patient, but please be careful of recruitment maneuver. It should be performed safely in a patient absolutely non-hypovolemic. This should be mandatory. Then don't forget that the tidal volume should be set according the ideal body weight that will be easily to calculate it by ideal body weight. It's 8 minus 100 for men and 8 minus 110 for women. As you know here, these two type of patient, one is very obese and another is non-obese, and they have also the same lung volume according the height of the patients. That should be recommend 6 to 8. That means 7 is a good number, and the PEEP should be increased. Then this is why the recruitment maneuver is very important. You have three situations here, three type of obese patient, and this is for surgery. As you know, from the top to the bottom is a group with PEEP. The bottom here, it's a group with recruitment maneuver alone, and in the middle you have PEEP plus recruitment maneuver. It's a gold standard. That means open the lung and keep it open. This is the CT scan obtained just before general induction. That means the patient is awake. This is immediately after induction, just 2 to 3 minutes after induction. Please note that all the three types of the patient, whatever the strategy of ventilation used, the patient developed here atelectasis, as you shown here. So what happened in the PEEP group? In the PEEP group and in the recruitment group, no modification. That means setting a PEEP, you did not decrease the atelectasis. The same is true for recruitment maneuver. However, in the middle group, which associated recruitment maneuver, that means is open the lung, and PEEP mean it's keep the lung open. See what happened here is the lung is reopening. And this is why it's important. Putting PEEP alone, it's not enough. Putting recruitment alone is not enough. However, association of recruitment maneuver, that means open the lung, and PEEP, meaning keep the lung open, you can observe the decrease and the no occurrence of atelectasis. That's why it's important to associate both. Then, in conclusion, the take-home message, the three major points that I want to be very easy. First of all, for pre-oxygenation, please consider as early as possible to use for pre-oxygenation positive pressure, whatever, CPAP alone with 8 to 10 centimeters, or association of in non-invasive ventilation pressure support around 5 centimeters of water plus PEEP of 5 centimeters of water using a high flow or a FiO2 100. This to increase the oxygen stores. Second, in intraoperative, you can use volume or pressure mode, as you said, but please limit the tidal volume less than 10. Then we recommend between 6 to 8. And then to be decrease the tidal volume, you should add a PEEP value around more than 10 centimeters of water. This associated to recruitment maneuver. This, using this, you can protect the ventilation. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Samir, for this brilliant talk. It was very nice, and I'm sure that people in front of the television have a lot of questions, so you can ask the question live. Before receiving your question, I have one question, Samir. Regarding intubation of the obese patient, is it more difficult than in non-obese patient, or do you think it is the same? Do you have particular advice for the intubation of such patients?
This is a good question. In the practice of our management of obese patient, we have today more and more recent data suggesting that the difficult intubation in obese patient is at least twice or more than the non-obese patient. This is demonstrated in the majority of the type of surgery due to, as we shown, the collapses and the tongue, and then it's probably associated with an increase of morbidity. Then the message is probably to try to increase the oxygen reserve. As you know, making an pre-oxygenation with just the balloon, that mean with known positive pressure, as the patient is in supine position, you increase the atelectasis and then you decrease the oxygenation reserve. Then using a positive pressure, it allows to limit the collapses during pre-oxygenation and increase the oxygen reserve in case of difficult intubation. That now it will be recommended for the majority of the obese patients to use at least CPAP. It's very easy now because the last generation of anesthesia ventilator, PEEP alone, that means CPAP or pressure support ventilation, are available for the most last generation.
Thank you very much. And for the device to intubate, do you advise a video laryngoscope, for example?
In the last 2 or 3 years, we have some very interesting data suggesting that video laryngoscopy could be performed probably in the majority of the beds. And now in Montpellier Hospital, we started a strategy that we try in the next 2 or 3 years to have in first strategy to use video laryngoscopy for all patients. But now we start probably in some specific case, including obese patients, to start first with the video laryngoscopy. I think that all video laryngoscopy could evaluate it in this situation, and we have really in our practices the feeling that it will be probably better to use the video laryngoscopy first, if it's available.
Okay, thank you. So we have one question from Aurelia about ventilation of obese patients. What is it better, pressure or volume?
This is a good question, because we have some literature suggesting that pressure mode could be for interest by limited the high pressure. In fact, this is true, but using pressure mode, you should absolutely be careful about the tidal volume delivered. Then if you use pressure mode, please be very careful about the delivered tidal volume, because during surgery, especially when you use a stereoscopy with a pneumoperitone, you have an evolution and a modification of the respiratory mechanism during surgery. Before pneumoperitone insufflation, at the end of exsufflation, and this, there is a modification during surgery practice. Then the mechanic of the patient will change. Then according the mode that you use, if you use pressure, the tidal volume will change, that you should be careful at exsufflation because the tidal volume could increase. In contrary, if you use volume mode, the pressure will change. Then you should be careful to the pressure, mainly plateau pressure, which is a surrogate of the risk of baro and volo trauma. Then the answer is, use pressure or volume are probably similar if you be careful of the monitoring. And this should be absolutely use the mode that you have the experience, probably in each. But you have today no randomized control trial suggesting that one is better than the other in terms of clinical relevant parameters.
Great. Jérôme, you have a question? No, it's okay. So maybe you can still ask a question to Professor Jabert, and he will answer next after the talk of Dr. Jérôme Yautier about intraoperative drugs.